sanctified lips and eyes. Proverbs chapter 4, verses 24 to 27 is the text for our consideration. The eyes and the mouth are two little organs that can significantly influence the course of a person's life. What we say and what we see affects how we behave and ultimately our standing before the Almighty God in the day of judgment. They are the precursors, as it were, to our actions. And Solomon, after all his sayings, you know, he was a man who wrote many proverbs. He was a man whom God endowed with great wisdom. Out of it all, he gave this last statement at the end of his life. He says in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 14, "For God shall bring every work into judgment, and every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil." He tells us that there is an ultimate reckoning in the lives of God's people, and he wants us to live in the wake of that understanding. And we thank the Lord that we have been awakened to the truth that there is an Almighty God who rules this universe. You know, in this world that we lived in, the theory of evolution seemed to be ruling the roost in the educational system in the last 50, 60 years, that man came from apes. No origin, or we said a senseless origin. If we have no accountability, then where is the relativity for actions, for our actions? How do we measure it? Is there no way to understand what is right and what is wrong? Is there a way to a yardstick for these things? Well, for us, we thank God that he opened our spiritual eyes. He reveals his laws to us, that we are not, we did not come from apes who chattel without sense, but we were fearfully and wonderfully made by the Almighty God and in his image. And that makes all the difference, because he tells us that at the end of life, there is a day of reckoning and a day of judgment. And what we say, what we do, the path that we take is consequential. In other words, there is a cause and effect to our actions. So Solomon is keenly aware of this at the end of his life. And we spoke about how a man's destiny first begin with the thought that is in his heart. And we say this in verse 23. That was the focus of our text last Lord's Day. "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." And we said how important it is that in all our keeping, keep our hearts, that invisible part of us, the thought life, the inner life that man cannot see, the unseen, we said, the unseen, the unheard, our intentions, our tendencies, our feelings, the makeup of our inner being, which Solomon calls the heart, and its movements and its motions. He tells us that let the word of God convict, correct, construct a heart that would bring forth the life that God will make good. And so he tells us the remedy, verse 20 to 21, the result and the result. He tells us that in all our keeping, keep our hearts. And he tells us indeed that the heart heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And recall, we also mentioned this old saying, the natural heart is a fountain of poison, but the purified heart is a well of living water. As the fountain is, so must be the streams. And so the Lord bids us to examine ourselves. He said, take yourself out of yourself and look at yourself. Examine yourself. Understand yourself. What is going on in your heart? The motions of your heart. Look at it. Jesus says, those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. That is why the world is so chaotic. Because the heart that is polluted. And so we said how important it is that the heart be made clean. How important it is that there is a way out to cleanse the polluted, corrupted, the dirty heart. And we said that in the gospel of Jesus Christ is that flowing stream of cleansing when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ to confess our sins before Him, to acknowledge His love for us, how He has died for us, how He has washed away our sins by the spilling of His blood. And that sins can be cleansed, sins can be washed away. So the Lord tells us that indeed there is a way out. And we are thankful to God for providing that way out, that cleansing of the inside. And then comes the new life, the abundant life that Jesus promised to His disciples that we are to live. And so today, we are going to look at how that life can be lived for maximum profit. Today we are going to say, we are going to look at the input and the output of the thought life. Right? The input, one of it, we said, the ears, the eyes, what you see, and the output, what you say and what you would do. And these things matter. They determine who we are. You recall last week we were mentioning the words of this man, Thackeray. He says very wisely, sow a thought, reap a word. Sow a word, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, rip a character, and sow a character, rip a destiny. God has given to us this new life in Christ, and He tells us that we are to live it to the full. And how can we do so? Three thoughts. Keep clean, keep clear, keep consistent or controlled. Verse 24, 25, 26, and 27. Or be clean, be clear, be consistent, be controlled. 24, 25, 26, and 27. The first thought, keep clean or be clean. Put away from thee a froward mouth and perverse lips. Put far away from thee. Take away from you the crookedness of the mouth. Take away from you the crookedness of the mouth. Right, this word froward, this word perverse, has the meaning of crookedness, a bending way. And it's interesting that the word for sin, there are three words that describe sin. Remember? Transgression, sin itself, and iniquity, transgression or rebellion against God, sin against the standard of God's word, and iniquity, a bending in the outworking of sin in the life of working of sin. And the word there means abandoning. Crooked. Crooked. And sin has that tendency to manifest itself in the crookedness of life. And it tells us that it begins, well, it comes with the mouth gate. So how can the Christian live a life that is pleasing in the sight of God? He says, put away from thee a froward mouth. Put away. What does it mean to put away? He tells us that the words that comes out of our lips, may it be measured. May it be measured. And perverse lips put far away from thee. So he's telling us to beware of the crookedness of mouth and the twisted speech. He tells us that we are born in sin. No one is free from its pollution. But those who are free by the blood of Jesus Christ, God has given to us a power of speech. God has given to us the ability to speak a good word. God has given to us the ability to bring forth goodness out of our mouth. Not filthiness, but goodness. And the Lord tells us that it is true. There are times when there is the slip of the tongue. There are the times when we felt provoked. And then, you know, we become inconsistent. And then we begin to speak those words which we ought not to speak. And then what happens? We regret. How is it that the believer who, well, we have spent time in the study of God's word, we have spent time with God, cultivating our soul, can in that moment of haste speak those unfriendly or speak those hateful words? And these things you would see is a devastation. And you can see it in family life, amongst members of the family. How, you know, especially among people closest to us, how there is that tendency for hate speech. For the people around us, near us, closest to us, how can it be? And we said that it is not far in the Christian home that these words are uttered. Let us realize that, you know, for every word that we say, God is one of the hearers, or God is one of the listeners. What we say, the Lord holds us accountable. Jesus gave these words of warning to us. Matthew chapter 12, 35 to 37. Will you turn there with me? Matthew chapter 12, 35 to 37. And he bids us to pray for the grace of a good speech. The next time you want to say something and you know that it is going to hurt, pray God give you that restraint. God give us that restraint. Matthew chapter 12, 35. Shall we read together? 35 to 37. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak. They shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Now we realize how we must not irritate the people around us by our inconsistencies, those things we ought not to say, how they are spilled out so easily. And we feel ashamed for what we ought not to say. And we come to God asking for forgiveness. But there must be that resolved, there must be that understanding within our hearts that these are things that would defile us, that there is a place for punishment. It must strike some fear in our hearts. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, for by thy words thou shalt be condemned. James, he was speaking to the church that was scattered all over Asia Minor, speaking to Christians. Why does he have to use these words? Well, to speak, to warn the people in the church to have a controlled tongue. He says this, even so, the tongue, James chapter 3, verse 5, is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. This is the word that we said, the bending, the frowardness, the crookedness. So the tongue is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. It speaks to us of grave words of judgment, to bid us to be careful. Jesus said to the Pharisees, we have read earlier in chapter 12, 35 to 37, in verse 34, it says, O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. He is speaking not to those who do not have God's word, but he is speaking to those who have the word of God with them. And yet, how the word of God is not making a change in their lives. How is that so? A froward mouth, a hastiness to anger, a rashness of speech. Of gainsaying, of backbiting. How sad it is. The Lord says, put these things far away from us. There was an author who puts it quite well. Verse 24, he says, a careless word may kindle strife, a cruel word may wreck a life, a bitter word may hit and steal, a brutal word may smite and kill, a gracious word may smooth the way, a joyous word may light the day, a timely word may lessen stress, a lovely word may heal and bless. How powerful is that little tongue. So Solomon is very concerned that the believer be sanctified in his speech. And he bids them to be careful that they can choose either to speak words that would build others up or to bring them down, spiritually speaking. And so within the family, the husband's communication with the wife How is it going? Is the husband's speech building the spiritual life of the wife? If the wife's speech building up the spiritual lives of the husband, in the sense that is it helping to bring peace and harmony and joy to the Christian home? And then the speech, we said, between parents and children, how is the father speaking to the son? How is the father speaking to the daughter? Are the words provocative? May it not be. May God be merciful unto us to grant us a sense of temperance, of a controlled speech, that the words that we utter may bring honor and glory to the name of God. And James, he observed very well. He says this: but if ye have bitter envy and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil. And so words come because of, for strife, for envy. The Lord says these are the spiritual sins that we have to be careful how these words can wreck a fellowship in the church. And James highlighted this because he's concerned. Right? You see, he was speaking to the church that was scattered all over Asia Minor. Life was tough because they were facing great persecutions to live the Christian life during those early years of the church. It means great sacrifice, sacrifice of livelihood, oftentimes sacrifices even of the home. And to live that life is really difficult enough. And the unsanctified inside of us, the strife and the envy, the heart that is not mortified, creating and bringing havoc to the already persecuted and afflicted community of God's people. So the Lord says that, wow, let us be wary. Let us be wary of these sins. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. So the Lord tells us how our words can sow strife, discord, or they can sow, bring peace and harmony. And so how we need to think and consider before we would speak, whether it is at home, whether it's in the church, whether it's in the workplace. Well, the Lord bids us to bring forth a sanctified speech. And then he said, our second thought, we said, keep clear, let thy eyes look right on, verse 25, let thy eyelids look straight before thee. Jesus says, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thy eye be single, the whole body shall be full of light. If thy eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. And if therefore the darkness that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? And so he tells us that how, what we see, how it affects that inner life within us and how important it is that we guard the eye gate. We're going to speak a lot about this next Lord's Day as we consider the passage in Proverbs chapter 5 concerning how sanctified eye can wreak havoc to one's life. And the third thought, verse 26 to 27. Be consistent or be controlled. Ponder the path of thy feet and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil. Ponder. The word ponder means to weigh. To consider the path that is before you. And let thy ways be established. In other words, there is a need to keep in consistency the way of life that is in God. I repeat again, there is a need to keep a consistency. Our way of life in the Lord. When we take time to imbibe the principle of God's word in our hearts, then those principles must guide us, and that they must be consistently applied, consistently imbibed, consistently practiced. Our trouble, our weakness is often that we are not consistent. There is not that stability in our spiritual life. We can swing. One time we are okay, the next time we are not okay. Then we are okay again, then we are not okay. How is it? How is it like that? The spiritual life, you know, like a yo-yo. Inconsistent. That should not be. So Solomon tells us that he wants us to walk a straight path. Walk a straight path and let our way be consistent according to God's good word. Let our path be consistent according to God's good word. And you would realize that there is a wrestling within you. On the one hand, the flesh will tear you at times not to obey, to yield to God's word, to the prompting of the Spirit of God, to do what is right, what is pleasing. And there is that wrestling that is within us. So the Lord tells us that seek to win that battle. Seek to win that battle. Seek to have victory in your life. Seek to control what goes into your what goes through in the eye. Those things that defiles, those things that does not edify, do not build you up, then take them away. And those things that those words that are able to build up. So oftentimes we said, if you have nothing good to say, don't say anything. But if you are able to give a good word, a good word of encouragement, a good word of exhortation, a good word that would build up the next person, then, well, say it. And sometimes it doesn't mean that, you know, we do not, that the words that we say to another person would not be a word of correction for the other person. It doesn't mean like that, you see. But the Lord also tells us that if you see another brother or sister in Christ that is in sin, it is also your responsibility and duty to help the person, to point out. But the Lord says, do so with a meekness of spirit, knowing that we are sinners also. So when our Lord Jesus Christ dealt with the woman who was caught in adultery, he did not utter the word of judgment to her. You remember that incident? We were mentioning it in our weekly Pastora article today. How Jesus wrote on the ground and said, then he asked the people around, any one of you want to cast a stone at her? The people all felt themselves guilty. They all walked away. And what did Jesus say to the woman? Go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Jesus says, I understand what has gone on. But he was able to administer the truth. And the woman saw the inconsistency in her heart. And she repented. She went and sinned no more. And so the Lord tells us that we are, as God's children, salt and light to a sin-darkened world. And we have a role. And the Lord needs us to be filled with the Spirit so that we may be able to administer a consistent walk in our lives. And so he tells us, turn not to the right hand or to the left hand. Remove thy foot from evil. So he says that there is a way that the Lord wants us to live. The way that is pleasing in the sight of God. The way of holiness in the sight of God. How, you know, we may not be able to fully comprehend in a sense, if we do not take time to examine our lives, to study God's word, we don't know that our life is not pleasing in the sight of God. We don't know. And we go on living our lives. And there are those who, you know, can be Christians for many years, and yet there is no change. Why is that so? Because we have not taken time to look at our lives and to pray that God would help us to minister a change in us. And oftentimes, this change, this working of the Spirit of God to correct us, to cause us to go in the right direction, to move in the path, the straight way before God, takes time. It takes patience, time to sit before God in the study of God's word, whether it, you know, in a Bible study, in a personal devotional time, in the Sunday school class. Well, the word of God, by the Spirit of God, gives to us, points out to us in a very supernatural, miraculous, amazing way what's wrong with our life. And that, you know, is the power of the Spirit of God to help us. But we need to come under the sound of the gospel of the word of God and consistently. See, we must not say we attend Sunday school this week, next week don't attend. Then after that, we attend, then don't attend. So you miss first lesson, you take the second lesson, you miss the third lesson, you did the fourth lesson. But you don't have a picture of what God is saying. And how can there be good, consistent growth? So the Lord wants us all to grow. And God has provided for us many opportunities whereby we may learn the Word of God, that we may grow. And it would take time. It would take, it's painstaking. But, you know, to be able to sit down and sit still and to be able to have a heart to focus and to be in prayer and to let the Word of God sing in, come into our heart, let the Spirit of God convict us, show us what is wrong. And oftentimes I recall attending Sunday school classes, how it is so beneficial, so that when we begin work on a Monday, say, it's something that we can bring with us for the week. That's how the Word of God does for us. And little by little we grow. Little by little we grow. As we, when we are consistent to bring, to develop a good habit in the study of God's Word. And that is the key mission in the church, providing many opportunities, fellowship groups, in Bible study, various coming together, you know, that we may learn the things of God, the ways of God, that we may develop that consistency. Verse 26 says, let that thy ways be established. Not just one way or one aspect of your life, but all aspects of life. Let all thy ways be established. And so, there are many things in life that as we think about it, you say, hey, that part not good, inconsistent, need help. May the Lord give us that strength to keep watch, and may the Lord give us that strength to do what is pleasing in His sight. Keep clean, or be clean, verse 24. Keep clear, or be clear. Keep clear of those things that defile us. And keep consistent, or be consistent, be controlled. Verse 26 and 27. May the Lord help us. Help us to consider and examine ourselves. Begin this week. What goes in here? Make a note for yourself. And what comes out here? Make a note for yourself. And then make an assessment at the end of the week and say, okay, what have I done? How has it been for me? Whether it is within the family, with the people around you, or whether in your workplace, among your colleagues, in the school, among your fellow students. Do a stock take, or whether you know it is at home, with your family members. Do a stock take and build up a consistency for sanctified lips and sanctified hearts. May the Lord help us. Let us pray. Father, may thou be gracious to strengthen our hearts, bless our meditation upon thy word, and Lord, may
our life bring honor and glory to thy holy name. This I pray with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name. Amen.